Hi everyone, welcome to the session of CMC, Cellular Mobile Communication. In this class, I am going to give the demo on non-core channel interface. So in previous class, we have discussed that what is meant by diversity receiver, what are the advantages of diversity receiver. So those topics we have covered in previous session. And the last topic of this unit is non-core channel interference. So we have number of non-core channel interference. So what are the types of non-core channel interference we will discuss in this class. Myself Divya, EC department, Ramachandran Engineering College. So what is meant by non-core channel interference? The interference due to the non-core channel cells is known as non-core channel interference, as the name indicates. So that means the cells which are operated with different frequencies. We know what is meant by core channel interference so in previous sessions. So the other type of interference is known as non-core channel interference. And next, the first type of interference, non-core channel interference, is adjacent channel interference. In short form, we can also call it as ACI. So adjacent channel interference is resulting from the signals which are adjacent in frequency to the desired signal. So the signals which are nearer or adjacent to the desired signal will cause an interference. That interference is known as adjacent channel interference. And we can also say that because of extra power from a signal in an adjacent channel, can cause adjacent channel interference. Okay. So what is the reason for the adjacent channel? So before going to the reasons, so this figure represents the adjacent channel interference. So here we have one cell. This is the adjacent cell. Okay. Let us consider this cell is operating at 5 MHz and this one is operated at 5.2 MHz, which is very nearer to this frequency. Okay. And at some time, this mobile unit will experience the signal from this cell site. Okay. That interference or that type of signals is known as adjacent channel interference. Okay. So what are the causes for the adjacent channel interference? So due to the imperfect filter characteristics, which allow the nearby frequencies, we can have some adjacent channel interference. Because of the imperfect filter characteristics or improper design of the filter, we can experience a nearby frequencies. Then it leads to adjacent channel interference. So that means here, this cell is operating at 5 MHz and we are considering, and this one is operating at 5.2 MHz. So this should operate at 5 MHz. That means the filter which is designed at this mobile end will operate at 5 MHz. It will not allow the frequencies other than 5 MHz. That means it will not allow the frequency of 5.2 MHz. So that means the passband should be shorter. So if you are designing a filter in that way, then we can eliminate the adjacent channel interference. Okay. So that is the reason for the adjacent channel interference, because of the imperfect filter characteristics, which allows nearby frequencies leads to the adjacent channel interference. So how we can, that means this is one of the reason, and we can have some improper frequency assignment, as well as if there is some near and far interference, then also we can have some adjacent channel interference. What is meant by near and far and interference? What is, how we can assign the frequency channels? We will discuss in later sessions. Okay. Near and far and interference will come across in next slide only. So because of all these reasons, we can have some adjacent channel interference. How we can avoid the adjacent channel interference? So one of the technique is by strict design of passband filter, which allow only a short frequency to pass through. So if you're designing, that means by the strict design of passband of filter, it allows shorter frequency to pass read in, and it does not allow the nearby frequencies. Then we can eliminate the adjacent channel interference. Okay, so the interference due to between adjacent channels or adjacent cells which are operating with different channels is known as adjacent channel interference, and which are operating with nearby frequencies. And next, it includes, that means adjacent channel interference includes two types of interference. First one, next channel interference. Second one is neighboring channel interference. Next channel interference is the interference that means the channel next to the operating channel. The interference between the channel next to the operating channel, that is immediate one. Okay. Next, neighboring channel interference is the interference between the channel more than one channel away from the operating channel. The channel which is located more than one channel away from the operating channel. So let us consider the figure here. So if you see the figure, so here we have a cluster, seven cell cluster means here we have seven cells which are operating with A, B, C, D, E, F, G set of frequencies. So same frequency is assigned to this cell as well as to this cell. So these A cells are called co-channel cells. Okay, but these cells are called adjacent channels because these cells are operating with different frequencies. Not that means these cells are not operating with the same frequency. So these cells are operating with the different frequencies. Okay, and next channel interference means the interference due to next channel only. This is next channel to this cell or to this channel. Okay, so the channel due to the, that means the interference due to the next channel is known as next channel interference, and the interference more than one channel away from this channel, that means this is next channel. More than one channel means this channel. Okay, so the interference due to this channel to this channel is known as neighboring channel interference. Okay, so this is next. If the interference due to next channel or immediate one is known as, these are next channels. Okay, and this one is neighboring channel, which is located one channel away from this one cell away from this. Away from this desired. Okay. So next channel means immediate channel. Neighboring channel means which is away from one channel. Okay. And these are not co-channel cells. We should remember here. These are not co-channel cells. These are all non-co-channel cells. And next, what is meant by next channel interference? So next channel interference affecting a particular mobile unit cannot be caused by transmitters in the common cell site, but must originate at several other cells. It is not due to the transmitters in the same cell site, and it is due to the other cell sites. It is due to the other cell sites. That means the interference due to other cell sites. This is not due to this cell. This is due to the other cell sites, which are operating with nearer frequencies. And next, the mobile unit initiating a call on a control channel in a cell may cause interference with the next control channel in other cells. So as we discussed in previous, so the interference due to the next channel is known as next channel interference. Next, how we can reduce the next channel interference. So the filter with a short cutoff frequency or fall off slope can help to reduce all the adjacent channel interference, including next channel interference. As we discussed, if you design the filter in a proper manner with short cutoff frequency, with short pass band, it can help to reduce the adjacent channel or next channel interference. And what is meant by neighboring channel interference? The channels that are several channels away from the next channel will cause interference with the desired signal, as shown in the figure. Okay. So here we are assigning some fixed set of channels to each cell site. Each cell site is assigned by set of frequencies or set of channels, and how we can reduce this type of interference. A sufficient amount of band isolation between the channels is required for a multi-channel combiner to reduce products. So if you maintain some band isolation between the channels, then we can eliminate this type of neighboring channel interference. We should provide some band isolation between the channels. So next type of interference is near and far end interference. So here we have two types of near and far end interference. First one is in one cell, second one is in two systems, in cells of two systems. So in one cell, so normally in a given cell, normally motor vehicles are usually moving. So that is some motor, some mobile units are close to the cell site or some are not. So because motor vehicles in a given cell are usually moving, some motor or some mobile units are close to the cell site, moving towards the cell site, and some are moving away from the cell site. So the close-in mobile unit has a strong signal. The close-in mobile unit, that means the mobile unit which is moving towards the cell site has a strong signal which causes adjacent channel interference. That means the mobile unit which is moving or which is nearer to the cell site, then it causes some adjacent channel interference because of this mobile unit which is moving towards the cell site or which is nearer to the cell site, we can have some interference. And this interference is known as near and far end interference. And here we have a figure. So this is the figure which represents near and far end interference in one cell. So if you observe, here we have a cell site, and here we have our mobile unit A and mobile unit B. And this is the desired one. This is the desired one, and it should receive the signal from this mobile unit. But this mobile unit is far away from the cell site. And it is nearer, the mobile unit A is nearer to the cell site. This is nearer and this is far from the cell site. Okay. So because of mobile unit A, which is close to cell site, it can experience an interference signal or the strong signal from this mobile unit compared to this one. Okay. This is undesired one, but it is nearer to this cell site, it can receive the signal from this mobile unit. That interference or that signal is known as near and far end interference. Okay. So this figure, in this situation, near and far end interference can occur at the reception point of cells. Okay. And next one is in cells of two systems. So that means here we are considering two cells. So in this situation, adjacent channel interference occur at both the cell site as well as at the mobile. In this situation, adjacent channel occur at both the cell site as well as mobile. Okay. So let us consider the figure. This figure represents the near and far end interference in cells of two systems. So here we have two cells. This is cell A and this is cell B. Cell A consists of a cell site, that is cell site A. Cell B consists of cell site B. Okay. So here, for instance, from the figure, we can say that the mobile unit A can be located at the boundary of its home cell. That is, home cell means its own cell. So here our mobile unit A is located at the boundary. That means at the edge of this cell. Okay, at the boundary of its home cell. Okay, and next, but it is very close to the cell B or cell site B, as shown in the figure. So it is very close to cell site B, but it is very far from this cell site. But it belongs to this cell site only, because this is cell site A and this one mobile unit A belongs to this cell site, but it is far away from this cell site, but it is nearer to this cell site. Okay. And the other situation is, if mobile unit B were at the boundary of cell B of system B, but very close to cell A of system. So if you observe, Here we have another mobile unit B. So this mobile unit belongs to this cell set, because this is cell set B, this is mobile unit B. This mobile unit belongs to this cell set, but it is far away from this cell set. It is far away from its own cell set, but it is nearer to this cell set A. Okay, and so here in these situations we can have some near and far end interference. So here we have two lines. Solid line represents or indicates that interference may occur at the cell site A, and the dotted line indicates that the interference occurs at mobile. Here we can observe the interference at the cell site, which is represented as dotted line or solid line, and the interference at the mobile end, which is represented as dotted line. So the interference at the cell site A due to mobile unit B, because here the mobile unit is nearer to this cell site compared to mobile unit A. So hence this cell site may experience a signal or can receive a signal from mobile unit B. Okay, that is the interference which is experienced by cell site. And here in accordance with the mobile unit, so here the mobile unit is nearer to cell site B. Mobile unit is nearer to cell site B, but it belongs to cell site A. So because of because that means our mobile unit is located nearer to the cell site B and it is far away from cell site A, it can experience or it can receive or from this cell site, because it is closer to this mobile end. Okay, so this is the interference at the mobile end because of the cell site B, and this is the interference at the cell site A because of interference due to mobile unit B. Okay, so this type of interference is known as near and far end interference in two cells of two systems. Okay, so next one, crosstalk. So in crosstalk we have near and mobile unit. First one is near and mobile unit. So what is crosstalk, how crosstalk occurs? So crosstalk can crosstalk is also one of the interference. So crosstalk can occur when one mobile unit is very close to the cell site and the other is far from the cell site. So as we know, mobile units are moving from one place to another place. So this crosstalk or interference can occur when one mobile unit is very close to the cell site and the other mobile unit is far from the cell site. So next, when both the mobile units, that is unit A and unit B, which is close, unit A is closer to mobile cell site and unit B is far away from cell site. So these two units are calling to their landline parties as shown in the figure. So here we have a figure. So from this figure, we can say that this one is nearer to this cell site and it can generate a strong signal as well. And this mobile unit is far away from this cell site. It can generate a weak signal. Okay. So these two systems are this mobile unit is nearer to this cell site and this mobile unit is far away from this cell site, and it can generate a strong signal S2 and it can generate a weak signal. Okay, so these units are calling to their landline parties. These units are trying to calling a landline party, which is wide communication. We have wide communication, so that's why we have switching units here. So both the units are calling to their landline parties. Then the near end mobile unit has a strong signal. So as shown in the figure, the near end mobile unit provides a strong signal because it is nearer to this cell site. So the near end mobile unit has a strong signal such that the demultiplexer cannot have an isolation of more than 30 dB. So if the near end mobile unit or the nearer mobile unit generates a strong signal. If the demultiplexer can provide some isolation more than 30 dB, then we can overcome this type of interference. But demultiplexer cannot provide the isolation more than 30 dB, or it cannot separate the signals until that range. Okay, so the nearer mobile unit has a strong signal or provides some interference. So then the strong signal can generate a strong crosstalk, while the received signal from mobile unit B is weaker than signal A. So here this mobile unit B is far away from this cell site, hence it can generate only a weak signal, and it can generate a strong signal. Because of this strong signal, it can generate a crosstalk with this signal, okay, or it can generate interference with this signal. So this type of interference is known as crosstalk, and this can be eliminated whenever the B multiplexer provide some higher than 30 dB isolation. Then we can avoid the crosstalk here. So next one, this is the crosstalk in near with the near end mobile. If we have some near end mobile end to the cell set, then it can develop an interference, or it can provide some crosstalk. So this is the case here. And next, close in mobile unit. So when a mobile unit is very close to the cell site, let us consider our mobile unit is very close to the cell site, and the reception at the cell site is greater than minus 55 dB. The cell site receives the signals from that mobile unit, from the very close mobile unit, is greater than minus 55 dB. If it receives the signals greater than minus 55 dB, then the preamplifier at the cell site, we have a preamplifier at the cell site, then it becomes saturated. The preamplifier becomes saturated. That means it provides some intermediate frequencies or intermediate products as a result of nonlinear portion of amplification. So these intermediate products are unwanted frequency signals, which leads to the desired signal and produces crosstalk. So if the mobile unit is very close to the cell site, as well as if because of the mobile unit which is nearer to this cell site, the cell site receives the signals greater than minus 55 dB, then the preamplifier in the cell site generate IM products, which are unwanted frequency signals. And because of these unwanted frequency signals, these signals will combine with the desired signals and produces a crosstalk. Okay, so if you see the figure here, S2 is greater than S1. S3 is stronger signal, S1 is weaker signal. Because of this signal, we can have some crosstalk. It will be added to this signal and it develops a crosstalk. And in this case also, if the mobile unit is very close to the cell site, the preamplifier may generate IM products, that is unwanted frequency signals, and those signals will combine with the desired signal and produces a crosstalk. Okay. And next, co-channel crosstalk. Co-channel crosstalk means this is third type. This is fourth type. Okay. So co-channel in crosstalk. So co-channel crosstalk is the crosstalk generated between the co-channels. So normally the co-channel interference reduction ratio should be as large as possible to compensate the problem. So already we know if Q is here, what is meant by co-channel interference reduction factor, and how we are indicating, what is the formula. So we know all those equations we have discussed in previous sessions. So in order to avoid or in order to reduce the co-channel crosstalk, the co-channel interference reduction ratio Q should be as large as possible. Q should be as large as possible to compensate for the So here the co-channel crosstalk can be reduced by the large value of Q. So that is, if you take large value Q, if you are increasing Q value, if you are increasing Q value means you are increasing the distance between the cells, then we can eliminate the co-channel crosstalk. And fourth one is telephone line crosstalk. So sometime crosstalk can result from cable imbalance and switching error at the central office, and can be conveyed to the customer through the telephone. So in telephone lines, we have we can experience a crosstalk. So this crosstalk is from cable imbalance as well as switching error at the central office, that is MTS4, and can be conveyed to the customer through the telephone because of imbalance in the cable and because of switching error in the central office. We can experience this type of telephone line crosstalk. Okay. And next one is UHF TV interference. So two types of interference can occur between television as well as cellular mobile phones. Two types of interference can occur. That means the interference between UHF, that is television, as well as cellular mobile phones is known as UHF TV interference. We have two types of interference between the TV, that is UHF television, and 850 MHz cellular mobile phones. First one is interference to UHF TV receivers from cellular mobile transmitters. So because of cellular mobile transmitters, the TV receivers can experience interference. And second case is the interference of cellular mobile receivers by UHF TV transmitters. Because of TV transmitters, the cellular mobiles can experience interference. Okay. So these two types of interference we have in UHF TV interference. First one is the interference due to mobile transmitters to UHF TV receivers. Second one is the interference due to UHF TV transmitters to mobile receivers. Okay. And next, normally because of wide frequency separation between cellular phones as well as TV services, media broadcast, that may be TV or radio. The significantly high power levels used by the UHF TV broadcast transmitters, the likelihood of interference from cellular phone transmission affecting the broadcasting is very small. So because of wide frequency separation, because of large frequency separation between the cellular phones as well as broadcasting services, that is TV or radio, the interference will be low. The interference is very low. So, but there is a probability, there is a little probability or slight probability that when the cell site transmission is 90 MHz above that of a TV channel, when the cell site transmission is 90 MHz above that of TV channel, then it can experience this type of interference. That is the interference between the broadcasting devices or TV or radio to the mobile units. Okay. And it can interfere with the image response frequency of typical home TV. So the interference is very small because of wide separation, frequency separation between the mobile phones, that means broadcasting services as well as cellular mobile phone transmitting units. But still there is slight probability that when the cell site transmission is 90 MHz above that of the TV channel, we can have some interference.